Penguin Random House Audio presents The Profession, a memoir of community, race, and the arc of policing in America by Bill Bratton and Peter Knobler. This is the author, Bill Bratton. The Profession is dedicated to the more than 22,000 law enforcement officers who have died in the line of duty and whose names are enshrined on the National Police Memorial in Washington, D.C. Their ultimate sacrifice will never be forgotten. Cops count. Police matter. To my extraordinary wife and partner, Ricky, for her love, support, guidance, and sacrifices over the last 25 years. Without her, the last 25 of the 50 years we counted in this memoir would have been very different. Those who don't study history are doomed to repeat it, and those who study policing, no, we don't study history. John Timoney, NYPD. Chapter 1, The Assassination of Rafael Ramos and Wenjin Liu. On Saturday, December 20th, 2014, Ismail Abdullah Brinsley woke up in Baltimore and thought about killing himself. He'd been arrested 20 times, his friends had robbed and pistol-whipped him, and his girlfriend had dumped him. He still had her key, so at approximately 5:30 that morning, he went to her house and put a silver Taurus 9mm pistol to his head. After she talked him out of it, he shot her in the gut and ran. Now what? Brinsley could imagine the word on the street. He was a loser who couldn't even do suicide right. He didn't have the balls to kill his girlfriend. It only wounded her. He decided to go back to Brooklyn, where he was raised. Counting my time as a military police officer in Vietnam, I've been in the law enforcement business for nearly 50 years, and this kind of story is less unusual than you'd imagine. In fact, it is kind of typical. Police see a lot of men and women who put themselves in difficult positions, try to change the narrative of their life stories, to transform themselves into heroes. That morning, Ismail Brinsley was a bum who was going to be sought by law enforcement for brutalizing an innocent woman. He was going to jail, so he decided he was going to kill some cops. That July, Eric Garner had died while struggling with New York Police Department officers, and that August, Michael Brown had been killed by a police officer in Ferguson, Missouri. That November and December, grand juries had handed down no true bills, declining to indict the officers involved in either death. In the midst of all of this, the Black Lives Matter movement rose to the fore. It had first appeared as a hashtag in the social media world associated with the trial and acquittal of George Zimmerman in the 2012 shooting of Trayvon Martin, and then in the physical world in 2014, with the convergence of activists in Ferguson. Now the movement was being felt nationwide, driven in part by a roiling resentment of the police in the African American and other communities throughout the country. Throughout New York City, every day there were daunting demonstrations, large, small, medium-sized, in which people were yelling at the police. Demonstrators were screaming right up in cops' faces, "All police are brutal. You are murderers. You are racist." I know from a lifetime of police work that this is not true, but the perception had taken hold. The anger was real, though, even if the claims were not. For some demonstrators, the shouts were meant to provoke officers to prove the protesters' points. Our men and women exhibited enormous restraint, first in taking the face-to-face verbal personal abuse, and second, in working hard to facilitate people's protests by following them through the streets, blocking traffic so they could maintain their groups, setting aside appropriate sites, and making sure that the demonstrators were safe while demonstrating. This is, after all, America, where the right to protest is protected by our Constitution. All assumptions to the contrary, the police work hard to make sure free speech demonstrations happen, and happen successfully. In cities large and small, officers maintain the peace for every kind of protest imaginable. These were different. The police were the focus, not just the peacekeepers. They were being baited at every turn. Not until the summer of 2020 would officers see anything like this again. The internet traffic was all about killer cops. Cops need to pay. Cops should be killed. The rules against advocating violence had apparently gone out the window. A threat assessment and protection unit, TAPU, was getting buried in internet incitements to harm, assault, or kill police. They were almost overwhelmed by running these threats down. Furthermore, unlike a one-day march for nuclear non-proliferation, say, These protests were nonstop and snowballed through the fall and early winter. With this as a backdrop, Brinsley decided to make himself into an avenger. He had stolen his ex-girlfriend's cell phone. He logged into his Instagram account. Alongside a photo of the same silver-tossed 9mm handgun, he posted the message, "I'm putting wings on pigs today. They take one of ours, let's take two of theirs. Hashtag shoot the police. Hashtag rest in peace, Eric Garner. Hashtag rest in peace, Mike Brown." While on the bus, Brinsley called his girlfriend's mother. She recognized the number and, thinking it was her child, picked up. Brinsley apologized for shooting her daughter. She called the Baltimore County Police. "He is on Instagram. He called me and said something. I don't remember, like I'm sorry, or I didn't mean to do it, or whatever it was." The Baltimore County Police pinged the phone. They saw it was moving slowly northward in the direction of New York. Was Brinsley on a bus, in a car, on a train? They couldn't be sure, only that he was moving. Investigators found he had a prior address in Brooklyn. Maybe he was heading there. They telephoned what they thought was the Brooklyn precinct in which that address was located. "What? Where?" said the sergeant who answered. "Not us." He referred them to the right one. "You have an alert for this guy for attempted homicide. You think he might be headed here?" said the sergeant who answered the phone at the 70th precinct, or the 70, as cops call it. "Fax us what you got." Brinsley arrived in Brooklyn and tossed the phone in the garbage near the Barclay Center. He told some people he ran into in the street to follow him on Instagram. He said, "Watch what I'm going to do." Baltimore had made a wanted flyer. It read, "Please use extreme caution. Threats on police." The scan arrived at the 70 at 2:46 p.m. At 2:47, Brinsley stood in Bedford-Stuyvesant at the passenger side window of an NYPD cruiser. Inside were police officers Rafael Ramos and Wenjian Liu. Rafael Ramos had entered the police academy at age 37, more than a decade older than the average starting cop. He was married, with two sons, and both at work and home, Ramos was the picture of a person who cared deeply about the young. He joined the NYPD as a school safety agent and worked his way up to officer. He had been on the force only 3 years. Ramos was studying to be a chaplain. He was 11 days past his 40th birthday. Wenjian Liu left his native China when he was 12 years old. He called himself Joe and had been on the path to becoming an accountant when 9/11 changed his thinking. He first joined the NYPD as an auxiliary officer, an unpaid volunteer with no gun, just a uniform and a star-shaped shield. When two of his auxiliary brothers were murdered by a madman in Greenwich Village, he could have turned away. He could have said it wasn't worth it. Instead, 4 months later, he took the oath to become a New York City police officer. Liu often cooked for his immigrant parents. He made a great vegetable soup. He was an avid fisherman. He just got married that October. Liu was 32 years old and been on the job 7 years. At almost the same moment the Baltimore wanted flyer came out of the 70's precinct printer, Brinsley fired 4 shots through the cruiser's window, shattering the glass and hitting both Ramos and Liu in the head. The guy who was trying to recast himself as some kind of racial avenger had picked 2 officers who were part of the growing number of minority officers in the NYPD. 2 Con Ed workers who were stopped at a red light witnessed the shooting. They called 911 and followed Brinsley and tried to confront him, but he turned the weapon on them. "You want some of this?" They backed off, but after they saw him go down into the Myrtle Willowy Avenue's G-Train subway station, they flagged down a patrol car and told the cops where to find him. In hot pursuit, the officers cornered Brinsley on the platform. He shot himself in the head and died. Ramos and Liu were rushed to the closest hospital, Woodhull, and into the emergency room. My wife, Ricky Kleeman, and I had gone home for the holidays to Boston, where I was born. Normally, I would have had my security detail run me up there and back. But because it was Christmas, and the wife of Detective Akeem Faro, a member of my detail, was going to give birth, I had opted to drive a department car myself. At least if something were to happen in the middle of the night and planes and trains weren't running, I'd have the means to get back. We were in our hotel when my BlackBerry went off. It was Mayor Bill de Blasio. "We have 2 cops shot in Brooklyn." I immediately called the head of my detail, Inspector Tim Traynor, who had also been trying to reach me. It was now their job to help me get back. I rode the red light and siren from Boston and was surprised that people were yielding on the expressway. Boston is worse than New York about people not getting out of the way of emergency vehicles. I was working the phones, trying to get details on the condition of the offices and find the quickest way to get to New York. At the Rhode Island state line, I was greeted with a police escort to Green Airport in Warwick, where an NYPD helicopter was waiting. The emotion and anxiety were high. One of the most terrible parts of the NYPD commissioner's job is dealing with the death of officers under one's command. But at the same time, I was trying to project a degree of calm, even over the phone, that would reassure the people of the department that they were in good hands and that we would move forward with clear purpose. When cops get shot, as police commissioner, you always have the same reaction. You're deeply concerned for their safety. How badly are they injured? Is it debilitating, life-threatening? As often you don't know. But you have to put your emotions aside while your experience and training kick in and your brain starts to focus on a list of questions to be answered. What happened? Why did it happen? Who did it? What are we doing about it? At that initial stage, I wasn't directly.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.